And we will take tremendous risk as a nation when the submarine force is down at that those very low numbers in the mid to late 20s because of those decisions, which you know, we can talk about whether they were short-sighted or not, that were taken by the people that made those decisions. And so very, very important that thought, that this is a going concern, something you got to work on every year. You don't ever get to say, well, let's just not build some ships for a little while here. It just doesn't work. Before I introduce my great panel here, Secretary was bragging a little bit, and he gets to brag. Here are the names of the ships that we will commission in the next 12 months. Detroit, Montgomery, Little Rock, Gabby Giffords, John Murtha in the LPD class, John Finn and Rafael Peralta, Illinois and Washington in the SSN class, EPFs Brunswick and Carson City, TAG 66, Maury, AGOR 28, Sally Ride, and seven Coast Guard ships, I think. And those are all ships that are in production, serial production, production lines that are going, ships that we know how to build and we're building well. And I think that is just a tremendous, tremendous, tremendous thing. We're also going to do two lead ships. You saw just before Christmas the lead ship of the Zumwalt class. Zumwalt, get out to sea, and I'll let Dave brag on all the work done there. Great job by the shipbuilder, the program offices, the supervisor, the technical folks, everybody who had a hand in that. And I'll let him talk about that. And then the other lead ship that'll deliver this year is the Ford. We don't have a PEO carriers representative on our panel because they're out working on getting the Ford delivered this year, which is going to be a real tough challenge. I will say for Admiral Moore, we fired all the catapults, and there's a little bit of catapult testing left to do on the waste cats. We have transmitted on the radar, although not on all faces in a continuous manner. We've operated all the elevators, and they're all working, and the reactor plants are functioning and beginning to produce steam. So most of the risk is starting to fade away on that ship. But as Admiral Gale will let you know, the last 3 months or so of getting a lead ship with way too much technology in it to its initial trials, that's why Tom Moore and Yao Fan are not here with us. And so I'm glad they're off on that watch. And the last thing I have to point out, the Secretary mentioned a lot about energy, and we are in the middle of a revolution about energy on board our ships. We created a document, the Naval Power and Energy Systems Technology Development Roadmap. I just signed out an update to that roadmap, which really lays out how we're thinking about power distribution on our ships into the future. You know, like power distributions, you know, generators, wires, and breakers. What are we talking about there? Well, everything's different. The DG-1000, its integrated power system, electric motors, generation capacity well past what it takes to just do the basics for that ship. And its integrated power systems activation was a tremendous challenge for us. We learned just a ton about it. The Secretary talked about Macon Island, and we've begun the process of installing those auxiliary drives on some DDGs to achieve that sort of level of savings. Of course, the Lewis and Clark TAKEs already had a integrated propulsion system and electric drive. Ford has a significant, and the first time we've had 13,000 volt electrical distribution on a ship. That is a tremendous challenge, a new set of things. Don't know, the Virginia class distribution is unlike any submarine we'd ever built. And of course, Ohio replacement will be the first submarine with a production electric drive. We haven't tried it before, but it'll be the entire class with an electric drive on it. So. That document, which many of you in industry have looked at, I know we've gotten a lot of feedback on it. I think it provides a good roadmap for where we're headed. And if you're in that business, please give us feedback on it. It's an important document as we think about the future. The lineup of PEOs I've got here, Mike Jabaley, PEO subs, been in the job almost a year now, Mike?
Three months.
Oh, yeah. So he's ready. Like he's ready for
like
that
2 years, though.
Yeah. Dave Gale, who's just moved back to Washington from Bath Ironworks. Brian Antonio, who will update us on LCS. Admiral John Hill, who's likes to tell people he's the person that makes ships into warships. So it's all about the ships, but John makes them warships. And great to have joining us this year is Admiral Mike Haycock, who is PEO Coast Guard. He buys things other than ships, but is going to get us up to date on the Coast Guard shipbuilding program. So let me turn it over to my first first panelist, Mike Jabaley. Come on, Mike.
Thank you, sir. And if I could have the first slide, please. As Admiral Hilarides mentioned, I relieved Admiral Dave Johnson at the end of October. For those of you who remember him, he picked up his third star and is now the principal military deputy to Secretary Stackley. So it's good to have him continuing to work in the procurement business for the Navy. Quick update on where we are in submarine shipbuilding. The Virginia-class submarine is doing well. If you add up the yellow bumper stickers in the quads on this chart, we have 12 delivered to the fleet so far, another 10 under construction, and then six more under contract. The Block 3 contract, which included a redesign of the bow to include the Virginia payload tubes instead of 12 individual VLS launchers and a large aperture bow array instead of a sonar sphere, that resulted in the cost reduction that allowed us to build two for four in 12, as measured in fiscal year 05 dollars. That we've delivered two of those ships, and it's been every bit the improvement that we wanted. We already deployed the first of that block, the North Dakota, along with a dry deck shelter and the first UUV mission from a submarine in a real-world mission off of an attack submarine using Project 1319, which is two Remus UUVs. Very exciting beyond the classification of this room, but it was very successful. With Block 4, which is the block that Secretary Mabus was talking about, where we bought 10 ships for the price of 9, the focus of that block was on reducing the total operational cost of the class. A lot of design changes that would allow us to do periodic maintenance less frequently and take less time. And I'm talking the depot level maintenance that keeps you in the shipyard for a long period. So the goal there was to reduce the number of depot level maintenance availabilities for each ship from 4 down to 3, and in doing so, increase the number of deployments for each ship from 14 up to 15. So that was the 315 logo. The Block 5 is going to be focused on increasing capability. And I'm sure you all saw Secretary Carter's memo back to the Navy. One of the things he said in there was, we have to increase the capability that we're putting on these ships. One of the ways that was called out in that we're doing is the addition of the Virginia payload module. If you could go to the next slide. One of the reasons this is so important is when we retire the SSGNs, the first four Ohio-class SSBNs that we converted to guided missile submarines, when we start retiring those in 2026, 27, 28, we suffer a severe loss of undersea strike capability. The number of launchers from submarines drops down to almost 40% of what we have now. So in order to make up that 62% shortfall, the plan is to add strike capacity to the Virginia-class submarine by inserting the Virginia payload module, which will include four large Virginia payload tubes, each of which can take seven Tomahawk missiles. And then when you add that to the two tubes in the bow, it results in a total of 40 missiles per ship. The current program of record has us building 15 Virginia-class submarines through the end of the class that will have this capability. And then we're working as hard as we can to reduce the cost of the Virginia payload module such that we'll be able to build more Virginia-class with the VPM. It's much better from a contracting perspective, from a construction perspective, and for restoring launcher capability in the fleet. Next slide, please. The biggest priority, of course, is the Ohio replacement program. The absolute imperative to recapitalize our at-sea strategic deterrence has been stated over and over again by many leaders in the Navy and in the government. The Ohio replacement is how we plan to do that. With the Ohio-class submarines, we're already extending them from a service life of 30 years out to a service life of 42 years, which is something that we have never done before. The longest we have ever operated a nuclear-powered submarine is about 36 years on the USS Kamehameha, We're going to take the Ohio's to 42 years, and we have to do that because that's the only way that we can continue to provide at sea strategic deterrence until the Ohio replacement program comes into being. So that places two imperatives on Team Submarine. First, we have to sustain the Ohio's. We have to make sure that the maintenance on those ships gets done. We have to be sure we look at obsolescence management, and such that those ships are as capable as they were on their last day of service at 42 years as they were on their first day of service. And then the second imperative is that the Ohio replacement program has to continue on track, on schedule, within the cost constraints, so that we deliver the first Ohio replacement in 2028 and it's on patrol in 2031. Now, that's a challenge in and of itself because we're incorporating several new technologies into this program. A significant amount of the ship is a direct pull through from the Virginia class. Proven components, proven technology, proven construction techniques. However, as Admiral Hilarides mentioned, electric drive for the propulsion plant is something that we have not done in a production line on a submarine. Naval Reactors is leading this charge. Development of electric drive and the life of the ship core, which removes the need from refueling during a midlife overhaul, are two key components of the strategy for Ohio replacement program. The strategic weapon systems, which Vice Admiral Terry Benedict is running at SSP, is a continuation of the D5 missile with the service life extension and the systems that are on Ohio. However, the missile compartment is new. It is a new design in conjunction with our UK allies. We are producing a common missile compartment, which will go on both our Ohio replacement and their successor class SSBN. New fabrication techniques for the missile tubes and new assembly techniques into the missile tube module. So we're already hard at work producing missile tubes, prototyping the construction process and fabrication for the missile compartment, and it's going reasonably well. These are important things to de-risk to allow the production of this submarine to continue on time. And then for my final slide, I just have a layout of the submarine shipbuilding plan from the FY16 shipbuilding plan. And the colors represent the block contracts for the Virginia class submarines. The lines on Virginia are separated into two, those with Virginia payload module and those without Virginia payload module. And as I said, we're working to reduce the cost, so hopefully we can move some of those non-VPM down into the VPM category. And then you see at the bottom the Ohio replacement schedule. And you'll note that we build two fast attack submarines in each year that there's no Ohio replacement. For those years that there is an Ohio replacement authorized, we can only authorize one SSN. And that's purely a fiscal constraint, not a shipbuilding capacity constraint. The point here, though, is that there is an awful lot of work coming down the pipeline in submarine construction. And if you combine with it the carrier construction going on at Newport News, it becomes clear that the nuclear shipbuilding industry has both a challenge and an opportunity on its hands. The challenge is this massive amount of work and the imperative to get it done on time to continue our at-sea deterrence. The opportunity, though, is an opportunity for improved contracting methods between the government and the contractors such that we can enter cross-class procurement contracts, both for long lead time material, the components that are common to the various classes, and then similar components. For instance, the missile tubes on the Ohio replacement are similar to the missile tubes in the Virginia payload module. So if we can work with Congress to get authority to do things like advanced procurement, advanced construction, and continuous production, we can significantly lower the cost of the classes of submarines that we're building by smart procurement. And that is an imperative for us. I won't recycle some of the comments that have been made in the past years about the impact on the SCN budget of Ohio replacement. It is what it is. It's an expensive ship. We have to build it. But we understand that our imperative is to control the cost and reduce it as much as possible to allow for the continued construction of the other ships that our Navy needs. So to the Surface Navy Association audience, I tell you that we're very cognizant of that. We're working hard on it, and we expect to be successful. Thank you very much.
All right. Great job, Mike. Thank you for that. I think the man we've all been waiting for, Admiral Dave Gale. I'm not going to give him any more accolades he's already got. So over to you, Dave.
Am I on?
Yeah.
Okay. Good morning. It's great to have this opportunity to kind of give you a rundown on what I consider to be a very complex portfolio of shipbuilding that goes on inside PEO ships. I first want to recognize my two executive directors, Jay Stephanie and Bill Anderson, and the work that they do to help keep me square in the channel, fair in the channel, and the six program managers that head up the programs inside PEO ships. And I'm going to recognize them here. Mark Vandroff, 400D. Rear Admiral Select Jim Downey, 500. Captain Darren Plath, PMS 317. Mr. Tom Rivers, PMS 377. Henry Stevens, PMS 385. Henry, are you in the room? Okay, Henry owes me an awful lot today. Mike Kozar, PMS 325. And I want to give a shout out also, Admiral Hilarides has mentioned electric ship initiatives and concepts going forward. Steve Markle from PMS 320. Reflected on the slide, but he's a valued member of the PEO ships team. I've been in this job for about 18 months. Everybody's worked hard to keep me square and correct me in a complex business when I say something not quite square. Comments like what the Admiral meant to say are often used inside the PEO. And it's a continuation of my turnover with Dave Lewis from 18 months ago. That back then only took an hour, and I'm still 18 months into the job figuring things out. So I appreciate everything that Dave had done up to that point and the work that I've got at hand now. I also, as an opener, just want to I'll say a big thank you to industry, and not just the shipbuilding industry, but every other piece of industry that contributes in big ways, some part of what it takes to make a ship whole and complete. We sit around the PEO all day long talking about how hard our job is, how tough shipbuilding is, and we don't do any of it. It's done somewhere else in the shipyards around the country, and this is a tough business. We all know that, and we have good days and we have bad days in it, but I think the best part of being the PEO is that I'm right in the center of keeping the lines of communication open and working our problems together to a satisfactory outcome. As the slide indicates, and I only have one slide, the PEO is about $80 billion in portfolio, covers 7 ACAT-1 programs, 2 ACAT-2s, 5 ACAT-3s, and I will just say in the PMS 325 realm, among other things, they manage about 130 FMS cases with 78 different countries. So you go from big things like DDG 1000 and building, delivering big deck amphibs all the way down to doing small boat work for foreign countries. We work with 15 CONUS new construction shipyards around the PEO and manage about 150 contracts in doing that. And I'm going to just now quickly run through the different programs and give you some highlights. And I appreciate the opening comments from Admiral Hilarides about the successes we've seen on DDG 1000. For years, people always looked at it and said, too much concurrency, too much new stuff, too hard to do and get to sea. And certainly there was a significant task in getting that ship built, tested, and activated to a degree of confidence and reliability that we could take key systems to sea and test, not only test it at sea, but to build our own confidence that what we had designed and built could actually operate at sea and do it well. We had, I'd say, one strategy when I came into the job, and that was a single builder's trial followed by a single acceptance trial. But there was so much new and different and so many challenges and risks to be burned down in some of the systems that Rear Admiral Select Downey and I, working with Bath Ironworks, had come up with a plan to scale the test program to what was absolutely necessary to go to sea, understanding the ship would not be complete and not all tests complete, but we completed everything to a satisfactory outcome to the extent that we needed to go to sea and to build confidence. We set ourselves a very aggressive goal to do that the week of 7 December, and Fred Harris and I, are famous friends who talk usually sometime between 05 and 600 every morning on whatever's going on in the business. We took that ship to sea, and I got to tell you, it was as calm and controlled and as expertly executed as any sea detail a surface warrior would be proud of. It was an outstanding underway event. We tested a very complex automated boat handling system right after clearing the sea buoy. We brought up the propulsion plant, and by afternoon of the first day, we were doing 32.8 knots and hard rudders. It performed exquisitely. There were some lessons learned. There are some things that we need to go work on, but nothing that prevents us, I will say nothing that we can't overcome or prevent us from delivering that ship on 25 April of this year. We've got work to do, a lot of coordination, a lot of teamwork to get that done, but we're committed to a 25 April delivery, turning the ship over to Captain Kirk and his crew soon thereafter, and they get themselves trained, qualified, and ready to take the ship down the river late summer. And I think I can say probably unofficially, I think there's a Baltimore commissioning in the planning sometime in mid-October. My hats go off to everybody involved in making 1,000 sea trials successful. We go back to sea in a few weeks, in about a month, to do the completion of the builder's trial requirement, acceptance trials a month later, and ship delivery a month after that. Michael Mansour, 1001, is 84% complete and will be going into the water this coming summer. Linda B. Johnson, 1002, is 43% complete, and they're starting the integration phase of the various modules of the ship. In the LPD-17 LXR program office, we are going to be delivering LPD-26 this year, as Admiral Hilarides said, and LPD-27 will be going into the water here in a few weeks. That's John P. Murtha is the 26, and the USS Portland, future USS Portland, is LPD-27. We also, as you probably have seen in the press, the RFPs on the streets for LSD-28, the transitional ship to LXR. In support ships, boats, and craft, the PMS 325 portfolio, we are about to deliver the TAG 66, the USNS Maury, successful completion by VT Halter, and about to deliver that ship, a great performance by that shipyard. We've delivered the research vessel Neil Armstrong, AGOR 27, in September. That's out of Dakota Creek Industries, Anacortes, Washington. If you ever have never been to Anacortes and visited Dakota Creek, I got to tell you, what a neat shipyard. What a great place. Sally Ride, same ship class, will be delivering in the spring of 16. I also want to give a shout out to Safe Boats and the work they're doing in building Mark VI patrol boats. We've got 12 of those in the program. We've delivered four. And if anybody in this room gets a chance to go ride a Mark VI, hang on. It is a wave jumper, and it's fun. I had a great ride on one of those boats here a few months ago. And it was most interesting and exciting was the fact that the coxswain on this 5,000-horsepower boat was an E4 ET. And the kid was just loving life. Great time. So that's what's going on with I won't get into the FY16 appropriations. That stuff is out there, but there's some accelerations going on with tugs LCU replacement, which I may get into. LHAR, USS America, LHA-6 is in PSA right now. I think last year I had the chance to talk about what a great commissioning we had in San Francisco and how well the ship performed going around the horn. The ship continued to do well all the way through her sea squat. She's in, probably halfway to two-thirds of the way through her PSA right now. Joint Strike Fighter backfit, if you will, as a group of alterations going into the ship is certainly the critical path, and we're doing very well with that work with NASSCO in the lead out there in San Diego. It's a great ship. I got to tell you, as an example of how a pre-com should work to build a climate and a culture in a crew as you're building a ship, that ship is an example of how to do it. It was a great, great performance. We also have the future USS Tripoli under construction down at Ingalls. She's about 40% complete. And we have the LHA-8 award that's pending. That's an ongoing solicitation, as you're probably aware. Oh, I wanted to mention, if I can go back, I'm sorry, it was written at the top of my page. Go back to DDG 1000 for a second. Given the complexity of the ship, and kind of maybe following a little bit of what the Seawolf program had to do that many years ago, DDG 1000s for the post-delivery and the initial sustainment of the first three hulls will be a program retained inside PMS 500. I've got a concurrence with Mr. Stackley to stand up an organization in 500 to be named PMS 500F. That has a bit of an identity to it. And they'll own and operate the post-delivery test and trials, DTOT, initial IOC of the first hull and all the way through OWLD on the third hull. So about 7 years worth of effort will be retained inside PEO ships, inside PMS 500, in an organization to be named PMS 500F. Ship-to-shore connector, we've got four under contract, two under construction down at Textron. Textron has got a neat and soon to start producing automated production line for the bed, if you will, of a ship-to-shore connector, an LCAC replacement. Every time I visit there, they're further up their learning curve and a very impressive facility that they put together to build ship-to-shore connectors for us. LCAC SLEPs, of course, for any number of years it takes us to build a new LCAC, we have to continue to sustain the ones that we have, and we can maintain and execute the LCAC SLEP program inside PEO ships. And there's four craft were delivered in 15, and we have seven craft currently in SLEP. LCO replacement, I referred to that a little earlier. Ship-to-shore connector, as Chris Mercer named it, SCXR. I don't know why, we just call it LCO replacement. We've got an appropriation, an authorization language to accelerate the buy on those, and there'll be more coming on that soon. EPF, the former joint high speed, the designation joint high speed vessel, owned and operated by MSC and built by Henry Stevens and PMS 385. We've got five ships in service. We got permission from the CNO with all the concurrences in place to accept hull number six today, literally today. And we've got three ships under construction, hulls six through nine, and under contract EPF 10. And we're working on contract awards for 11 and 12 this year. I want to say on joint high-speed vessel, for anything that anybody would say about it, it is a high-performance ship. It's got a payload capacity of 600 tons. It does 40 knots, and it's made out of aluminum. There's a bit of operational learning going on with respect to the hull form, safe operating envelopes, and the reliability of some of the systems in those boats. But TK Shannon and I are working on that together, along with Austal, to make sure that what's built is built to the design. And if we have challenges with design, we can go work that together. So that's a story on EPF. And then ESB, the former designation of MLP, right. I've already picked up the new lingo and lost the old one. Two variants, if you will. The first two are ESDs, the dry dock versions, and then the ESB is the forward staging base variant. The first of those is in service, the Lewis B. Puller. And I think that that's another great collaboration as we take ownership of that in a two TICOM environment between Surflant and MSC to get that ship up and running from an operational perspective to deploy, and at the same time working some significant backfit efforts for soft capabilities. That's EPF-3, ESB-3. ESB-4 is under construction at NASSCO, and we're getting ready to work on the RFP and the award for ESB-5. That'll be the fifth hull. DDG-51s, certainly they're last on my list, but not least. Restart program is going well. We got 113, it's already been said, 113, 114 will deliver this year, 113, 115 will deliver this year, 114, 116 will deliver the following year. Two at Bath, two at Ingalls. Both yards are doing extraordinarily well and buying back the learning curve that you lose when you put a 5-6 year gap in building a class of ships. And I think the other good news story in DDG 51 restart is it is highly compatible, or I say comparable, to the modernization of a 20-plus-year-old DDG-51 in terms of its configuration and combat systems and HM&E systems. So there's a good marriage there when you're building something long enough that what you're doing in modernization should be or can pace the very thing you're delivering in new construction. And then 10 multi-years ships, DDG-50 multi-year ships, 5 at Ingalls and 5 in Bath, and some of the early hulls are under construction as I speak. And then, of course, the up-and-coming Flight 3, there will be, that's the AMDR integration into the DDG-51 class, and there's more to follow on that on our award for the first ship. And I won't be able to talk about that here today. So with that, I'll turn it over to Brian Antonio. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Dave. Well, good morning. For those of you that are following along in your program, you'll notice that I'm not Nita Sumrean, but it does give me an opportunity to give a shout out to the, I'll say new executive director, but it's new since the last time we all got together, came aboard January or February of this past year, and so the PEO has really benefited greatly by having Nita join us after 6 strong years as the cost engineer at NAVC. So despite what you may have heard in the press or read about program memos and the like, I will tell you LCS is still a program with momentum. And I'm going to run through some things. If I just go to the next slide, I took out the pinwheel chart. I know Admiral Katz said I changed slides at the last minute. I apologize, sir. But I just wanted to talk in general about where we were a year ago. We were all sitting up here doing the PEO panel, what we've got accomplished in the last year, and then where we're headed in 2016. Because I think that's important for people to get a sense of the kind of momentum that we still have in PEO LCS. So when we last met, or my tagline here is, what a difference a year makes, we had 6 program offices. And just like Dave, I'll give a shout out to the program offices. PMS 501 is Captain Tom Anderson running the LCS C-frame program. PMS 505 is Captain Scott Pratt. He's the Fleet Introduction and Sustainment PM. PMS 420, Captain Casey Moten, who is the Mission Modules Program Manager. PMS 403, Captain Bill Guarini, as the Remote Mine Hunting System Program Manager. Captain Dave Hanebach, PMS 406, as the Unmanned Undersea Vehicle Program Manager. And PMS 495, Ms. Melissa Kirkendall, is the Air and Surface Mine Warfare, including Legacy Systems in the PEO. So we had 6 program offices, and we were about ready to award the FY16. Yeah, I know it was 15, but if you recall, we had changed, there'd been a change in the ship profile from a 4 and 2 to a 3 and 3, and so we needed to take a look at how to manage the FY16 ships. And so we're about ready to award 2 additional ships to the block buy contract. We were just coming out of the Small Surface Combatant Task Force study and report. And in fact, 1 year ago, I didn't check whether it was actually today or not, but 1 year ago, Secretary of the Navy spoke right before this panel, and it's where he announced that the future SSCs were going to be called frigates. So we've had that now for a year. We were in the relatively early stages of Fort Worth's deployment to Singapore. She had been over there for a few months, but we were still kind of shaking things out and getting her over there and doing some comparisons with the way that Fort Worth is going to shake out compared to Freedom. We had just declared within the past couple months the initial operating capability for the Freedom variant, with a surface warfare mission package. She had completed testing earlier in 2014. We were waiting for the report that came out of the Commander of Operational Test Forces, and we were able to declare that IOC. And we were in the middle of the Mine Countermeasure Mission Package developmental testing, which, as you know, is more than just the remote mine hunting system with the remote multi-mission vehicle and the AQS-20 sonar. It includes things like the aviation systems that are in PMS 495, like the airborne laser mine detection system and the airborne mine neutralization system.
So for me, that was eons ago, even though it was probably about 364, 365 days ago. So since last year at this time, I've already mentioned a new executive director. I've added a seventh program management office to the PEO in Captain Dan Britzenhofer, who is the frigate program manager. And that's the PMS 515 that was stood up by Mr. Stackley. We've, in that program office, we've completed what we call pre-preliminary design. We've nailed down the requirements, and we're very close to coming up with the system selections for the frigate going forward. Came through a common combat management system decision, not to steal any thunder from Admiral Hill. Back on the shipbuilding side, we commissioned LCS-5 Milwaukee in what was a very interesting commissioning ceremony outside in 20-degree weather with 20-knot winds in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. It was so cold that day, I have a picture of the foam on the beer from the beer truck frozen. It's a true story, I have it. A couple weeks later, in a very much more warmer climb down in Gulfport, Mississippi, we commissioned LCS-6, and that was the commissioning ceremony that Secretary Mabus discussed a little while ago. We christened LCS-9, Little Rock, LCS-10, Gabriel Giffords, LCS-12, Omaha, and in about 9 days, we will christen LCS-11, Sioux City, in Marinette on, yes, the 30th of January. If anybody has any electric underwear they'd like to loan me, I would gladly be interested in talking with you. Fort Worth is still deployed. And we kept track of the metrics of Fort Worth's deployment compared to Freedom's deployment and how she performed on that deployment. When Freedom came back, we were a part of a lot of lessons learned with the ships themselves. Hey, what could we do better with Freedom? So Fort Worth, I would say, and if you talk to Admiral Font or Admiral Roden, I know they made some comments yesterday during their speeches. She is going strong, and from my perspective, exceeding all the performance baseline expectations, especially compared to Freedom. In fact, at the same, so Freedom was there 298 days, and we collected those metrics for the first 298 days for Fort Worth. She had 46 more days, she, Fort Worth, had 46 more days underway compared to Freedom in the first 298 days. She had a fewer number of CAS reps, and the CAS reps were fixed more quickly, and she executed two crew swaps as opposed to just one for Freedom. Staying on the fleet sustainment and introduction side, LCS Ron 2 in Mayport is now fully stood up, Commodore Paul Young, and we held a ribbon cutting in the fall for the LCS support facility, a beautiful building down there in Mayport. And I can tell you from visiting the base down there that everybody is really excited. There's a flurry of activity down in Mayport, everywhere from the LCS Ron to Southeast Regional Maintenance Center. It's almost like, hey, we got visitors coming, we got to get ready. Lots of activity on that base. So again, back to the momentum theme. Since last year at this time, we IOT&E'd LCS-4 with a surface mission package, which now represents the opportunity to declare initial operating capability for a trimaran variant. We also continued work in the anti-submarine warfare mission package by getting the rapid technology insertion concepts completed in industry, and we're in the process of reviewing those concepts so that we can continue the development of the engineering development model with an option here probably in the next couple months. And of course, the mine countermeasure mission package completed the technical evaluation over the summer. Lots of activity in 2015. So where are we headed in 2016? Well, we're going to fund LCS 25 and 26 in March, and that'll complete the 22-ship block buy for the LCSs. And we'll finalize the acquisition strategy for FY17 based on the results of the President's budget, which, as Secretary Mabus said, for now is pre-decisional. So don't ask me any follow-up questions on that, please. We'll deliver LCS 7, 8, 9, and 10 to the Navy. We'll continue supporting the Fort Worth deployment and prepare for upcoming deployments and underways. We will award the East Coast sustainment execution contract for taking care of the ships on the East Coast, and we'll continue alignment with more of the C-21 processes and policies. We will conduct the engineering for incorporating even more lethality on LCS. You heard the Secretary mention that earlier, specifically in the form of over-the-horizon missiles. And we will come through the engineering for that in the near term, and with a goal of actually deploying one of the ships with the over-horizon missile as we go forward. Still working with the fleet and the resource sponsors to nail down the funding and the timing for that. We'll continue testing for surface warfare mission package with the surface-to-surface mission missile module, which is increment 3 of the SUW mission package, for ultimately fielding it on an LCS in 2017. And for the mine countermeasure mission package, we'll of course follow the direction that comes out of the independent review team here in the next few weeks to put us on a clear and correct path for making sure we get that capability out to the fleet. So let me just wrap up. Hopefully you've had an opportunity to look at the slide while I've been talking, but there's still an excitement and a buzz in PEO LCS. It's apparent every day in the PEO, it's apparent every day in the fleet from the amount of support that we get. We're designing, building, delivering, and testing at an incredible pace. I hope I've left you with that impression. And we're not losing momentum. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Brian. I give you extra credit because John Hill told me he was really worried after the three shipbuilders got done, there'd be no time left. But John, we did leave you a few minutes to go. Tell us how you make all these ships into warships. Thanks.
Hey, great. Thanks, Admiral. Good morning, everybody. One of the things that Admiral Hilarides says to me periodically when I walk in the room, he'll say, well, welcome to the Bureau of Ordnance. And so I started putting the Bureau of Ordnance tag on my view graph there. So that's what that little design is in the lower right-hand corner, just to entertain the boss, right? So I do love the theme of this SNA, a view beyond the horizon. I mean, that is exactly where my head is. And so I kind of crafted my discussion this morning less on specific program efforts and more on what we're doing as we look downstream into the future. And of course, I don't do any of that myself. Every one of the ship programs that are represented here, to include aircraft carriers, has a different acquisition strategy. So the way that I work with the shipbuilders is different. When I meet with Dave Gale, sometimes we're providing the Aegis combat system fully tested, and we take it through OT. When I'm supporting the Zumwalt program, I'm managing a contract to deliver combat systems that will be tested by his future 500F. The way we work with LCS is based on how that ship is delivered by the shipbuilders. So the levers I have to pull there are fewer. So it's just different based on how the ship is aligned and how industry is aligned to do that, which makes it just great fun. Every week for me is a great one. I'm always excited. There's always a buzz for me because I typically will spend time with Admiral Gale, with Admiral Antonio, Admiral Moore. Less with PEO subs because we must be doing the ARCI program okay, and we're doing all right on delivering the tail to the ships. The other major partner for me is the Missile Defense Agency. So I'll talk a little bit about Aegis Baseline 9 as we track forward. But like everybody else, I don't do it by myself. I've got a great team. Mr. Stackley, the first question he asked me when I checked on board as the PEO last year was, hey, how is your team? And I will tell you, I have a fantastic executive director in Bill Bray, and I've got two great senior executives focused on two different things. Karen Davis helps me with that force-level engineering and combat systems, and John Fiore is my science and technology and element-level engineer. And none of this would be pulled together without a great stable of program managers. Rather than going through the 12 of those program managers, actually the 14 of them and the two commanding officers we have, I'll just kind of mention their names as we kind of roll through the flow. Our mantra is sea power to the hands of the sailors. I like it. It speaks to me. I think it speaks to our people. Sea power can be manifested in a lot of different ways. Sometimes it's with presence. Sometimes it's with posture. Sometimes it's capability. Sometimes it's capacity. For me, it's a missile going 200 miles downrange. All right, next slide, please. I didn't mention the importance of in the hands of the sailors. You know, when we deliver combat systems, depending on the level of responsibility that we have, they're working closely with our shipbuilder friends here and the modernization shipbuilders. I will tell you that we are often surprised by the feedback that we get from the fleet. They will do things differently, and I think that inspires us to think differently and be innovative. So there's been lots of discussion over the last few days about budget, either the goodness or the challenges presented by that. We've talked about innovation. I will tell you that I'm schooled by Admiral Meyer, who said we do nothing without industry, and I recognize that. Absolutely true. Admiral Gale was right. We're in our program offices, and the real work is happening in the field and in industrial sites. Our field activities, incredibly important to us, our warfare centers, our laboratories, and I make a large investment in those areas because we are generating the future combat power for our surface Navy and for submarines and for my good friend with the Coast Guard, because we do supply weapons and sensors to the Coast Guard, particularly the National Security Cutter. Very proud of that ship. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the 30-year Surface Navy Combat Power Plan. We had Admiral Roden in that war room right before Christmas, and he kept repeating the same thing to me over and over as he walked through the four walls, and we do what any good combat system engineer would do. We start at the threat. We identify our gaps. We take a look at technology, what needs to be invested in now, how we pull that forward. We align to the 30-year shipbuilding program, and we project forward by using something I call guide stars. We know we're going to be fighting in space. We know we're going to leverage space assets. We know it's not as easy as low cross-sections, onesies and twosies coming in. They don't care how small they are anymore. It's going to come in fast, and there's going to be a huge, large raid barrage. We know that's the world we're going into. So we have to engineer for that. We have to plan for that. So our systems will evolve in that direction. So Admiral Roden kept saying it is all about sea control. Then we went to the next wall. It is all about sea control. Got to the third wall. All about sea control. So if you haven't got the message about the importance of sea control in the surface Navy, there it is. Sea control is how we do project power. The other thing that we talked about is how we have to move to the offensive. And you heard Admiral Roden talk about that. Admiral Font talks about it all the time. And that's where we've spent our time really focused, is how we take where we've been, which is very defense-oriented, with our missile systems, with our combat systems, with our sensors, and how you take that technology that we have today and turn that around so that we can affect the calculus of the adversary. And that's really where we're going. We know that every AOR is different. We know that the demands from the combatant commanders will be different. So we have to take a look at the force in that theater and what capabilities they need on those ships at that time. And it requires a lot of flexibility. So, you know, right back to innovation and how we think as an acquisition program office. Next slide, please. So this is just one of a million different lightning bolt sites that float around in Washington, D.C. I just knew we couldn't have a great SNA if I didn't throw this up there. But it does not show the full complexity, because I noticed as I was staring at the slide, it's missing things like the multifunction towed array and our undersea warfare efforts that are led by Captain Harrison. Captain O'Connor runs our electronic warfare and our radars, electro-optics shop, and IR. And I tell you, the kind of mind-boggling things that we're doing with our future sensors are just incredible. Where we are with the SPY-6, the air and missile defense radar, the AMDR that is aligned to the Flight 3, is going to be a major game changer. And because it is new, I don't think that everyone has a full understanding of what the power of that radar will bring to us. The power of that sensor will be incredible. The Flight 3 will be an incredible ship. And so we're really looking forward to deploying that. We just came to full power on the full array, which is built. It's in the near field test range today. It moves out to PMRF, where there's a target rich environment against ballistic missile targets. We are going to fly supersonics against it. We're going to fully test that radar and de-risk it before we deliver to Mark Vandroff's ships downstream. So the other great story that I can tell you about coming off of this chart is where we are with the latest Aegis baseline, baseline 9. We are completing our operational testing. We were not able to finish our supersonic testing this last December because of weather, and we're going to wrap that up later this year. We did the technical capability declaration on Aegis Ashore. The cruisers have come through their OT, and we are at the integrated air missile defense destroyers. And our test ship that we designated from the Navy with the Missile Defense Agency, the mighty USS John Paul Jones, is heading back out on the range this weekend to go do an extension of NIFCA, and we're very excited about the work that we're doing there with integrated fire control. Okay, next slide, please. So future sea power, you know, when you really look at it and try to figure out where you're going over the next 30 years, we know that we can't be very specific out there at the 30-year mark. But we do know that there are certain guide stars that will drive us. And this is no aha moment for anybody in the room here. We have to look at all domains, right? And we go back and look at the CNO's strategy and where we're going. Every domain is important. So looking at space, leveraging that, not 30 years from now, leveraging it today. We are doing experimentation today using space. We know that we have to look and work with the air community. So how do we get tracks from an F-35? How does that come in and complete the fire control loop for us? That is an extension of NIFCA. The more sensors we have, the more robust that fire control loop is, and the more opportunities we have and options for the combatant commanders as we move forward with these ships. We have to look at the subsurface domain. We know that in the electromagnetic maneuver warfare scheme that we're going to operate in areas where we will be denied the use of GPS. So we can use things that go under the water and use that media. And it's wildly different. That's a different set of physics underwater, but we know we can communicate there, and we are pursuing options there. So looking across all domains, subsurface, space, air, is pretty key for us. Next chart, please. Okay, so the future of sea power. This chart's more about the near term. Admiral Antonio just mentioned the over-the-horizon capability. That is exactly the strategy of changing to an offensive view. You heard the use of the term stick today. This is the near-term stick on LCS. We're looking at longer range over-the-horizon missiles for other ship classes. There's been lots of talk about Navy integrated fire control. That is going well. And that was no non-trivial action. We came up with that idea really years ago when we brought cooperative engagement to sea, and we said we can really use remote sensors. And when we first did that, it was Aegis to Aegis. We took our most precision, high precision radar, and that's what we combined into composite tracks. We are now bringing in remote data from all radar types, and every new radar that comes to the surface Navy, we now take into cooperative engagement, and we can extend. We have the situational awareness and the common operating picture that the warfighter needs to operate. So very excited about that. We are putting CRAM on the rotor DEGs for a very tough threat area and a very tough area to operate to give those ships another layer of defense. So this is really the first time that the RAM missile is going on board Aegis destroyers. So we're excited about the opportunity space that opens, and we're going to look forward to taking care of those ships. We just delivered the first CRAM mount to the waterfront, and it'll go on USS Porter, and then we'll continue our test out there. And what's really amazing is we're taking advantage of Spanish ranges. We're going to be conducting sea squats on those ships in a different theater. We normally don't do that, but it is a great opportunity. And some of you may have known that we just completed back in November the Maritime Theater Missile Defense at Sea demonstration with eight other countries, and we launched a ballistic missile target for the first time off of British soil, and we took it out with an SM-3 coming off the Mighty Ross, who is a Rota DDG, and we also had the Sullivans coming from the East Coast. Because the other thing we want to do is exercise different tactical command situations for command and control, and that leave behind laydown that we have for conducting integrated air missile defense with our international partners in Europe. We have laid that down, and that construct will continue to be used. Okay, so next chart, please. The last thing I didn't hit on the last one was the importance of changing how we do business. I cannot fully support the shipbuilders unless I do things more efficiently, right? If we want more baseline 9 ships out there, we've got to draw the cost down of what it takes to install, what it takes to develop, and we've got to speed up the velocity that the CNO likes to talk about. The velocity of learning is exactly what I'm talking about here. We have done some amazing things with the Common Source Library. When I mentioned Aegis Ashore, air defense cruisers, integrated air missile defense destroyers, Coast Guard ships, and even a variant of LCS, they're all coming from the same Common Source Library. That's a major tax savings to you as an American citizen, and it brings incredible power to our ships and great flexibility and commonality that really means something to our sailors. I met with our enlisted team recently, and I walked away with one great quote that they said, is when you deploy a system out there, we walk on board the ship, we expect to operate and maintain those systems. All too often, we spend our time troubleshooting. That's a major message to me, because when we deliver a combat system, the training's got to be there, documentation has to be there, we have to account for spares, and that is something that we're putting a special emphasis on as we move in the future. Common equipment. We've got the same display capability on the Zumwalt ship that we have on a destroyer, that we have in Aegis Ashore, that we have on the cruisers, that is pretty cool. We're pretty excited about that. And how we populate data to the display that the operator sees is pretty amazing. So I think the last one I'll talk about is where we're going with electronic warfare. Far too long, and I remember as an ensign in SWO destroyer school years ago, they kept talking about someday we're going to do hard kill, soft kill integration. We're going to be able to save missiles by leveraging electronic warfare. We just got to make sure we can trust that electronic warfare. I think we have entered the realm of doing that. Not only are we now fully integrating our electronic warfare capabilities with what we see on the radar and determining how many missiles we'll shoot and who will shoot that because we're connected ship to ship, that calculus, again, is changing. And so we're very excited about where we're going with electronic warfare. We have the Block 2 CWIP system out there on Bainbridge today. We're getting ready to go to operational test. The feedback we're getting from the ship is eye-watering. And again, when you put it into the hands of the sailors, you are surprised what you find. And I tell you, they are doing amazing things with that system. So we're very excited about that. I think the future is bright. I'm looking forward to hopping on a plane this Saturday and heading out to the range to see the mighty John Paul Jones in action. And that's it for me. I'll turn it over to my good friend, Admiral Haycock.
Well, good morning. I am embarrassed to say this is my first Service Navy Association. Apparently, the Coast Guard is too small to have a Coast Guard or Service Coast Guard Association. So I appreciate the invite. Thank you for allowing me to participate. I'm not going to thank all my PMs and such because we got about 18 programs. But I do want to take an opportunity just to thank the other PEOs up here because the Coast Guard were pretty small. And so we take advantage of every opportunity to leverage work that's already been done elsewhere. So we've leveraged a lot of Navy programs, in particular stuff from IWS. You know, we couldn't do what we do without them. And so as Admiral Hill has said, he makes Navy ships into warships. Well, he makes Coast Guard ships into warships too. So I've got about six slides. I think my staff probably thought that if I want to keep up with my big brothers here, I would need volume. Or it might be that they thought the pretty colors might distract you from what I'm going to say. Probably two of them are really the most important ones. So if we can just go to the next slide. So the intent of the slide was really just to kind of juxtapose two things. In the lower left corner, you'll see our national security cutter and the C-144 medium range surveillance aircraft. And those are some of the newer assets that have entered the Coast Guard fleet. In the upper right, you see a picture of Coast Guard cutter Reliance. So to put that in perspective, Coast Guard cutter Reliance, you'll notice, is missing the Coast Guard stripe. Coast Guard stripe was used by the Coast Guard in about 1967. So that kind of dates that photograph for you. And that kind of shows you how old our fleet is. So if I can go to the next slide. So this slide, the intent, it's a little bit of an eye chart, but the key here is you can see all the different classes of ships we have in the Coast Guard. And then green is service life and red is beyond service life. So you'll notice there's a lot of red on there. I'll talk just about a few of those classes. But at the very top is a high endurance cutter, 378-foot high endurance cutter. And those cutters were, the keel was laid in like 1967. We had 12 of those. And those are you might say, more of like a fast frigate, a force projection sort of thing. Great ships, but they use gas turbines that are the same gas turbines that were used on 707 passenger aircraft in the 70s. So that kind of tells you how old they are and how difficult it is to maintain them. So their replacement is the NSC, the National Security Cutter. And so you can see at the end there, the arrow showing National Security Cutter, kind of the reliever for the 378. So 378 fleet is now down to about half. You start at 12, is now below 6, because the NSCs are coming online. So we have 5 NSCs out there, 6, 7, and 8 are in construction. And we have money in our budget in 16. To build a ninth above and beyond our program of record of 8. I think those of you who listened to Admiral Zumkampf, our commandant yesterday, talked a little bit about that. The next two classes below that are our 270s and our 210s. Those are medium endurance cutters. So the 270, the top one, joined the service in the early 80s. As you can see from the green line there, she reached the end of her service life in about 2013-ish. So we did a mission enhancement program that we started in about 2005, 2006-ish. And that really, what we were doing there was upgrading select systems to bring the operational availability of the cutter class up. And but those it wasn't a service life extension. It was really there to make it more sustainable. We probably bought 5 to 7 years of additional service life by doing it, but we're going to need to do something about that class here in the near future. The offshore patrol cutter is our answer to that. Right below that's our 210-foot class. That picture of Coast Guard cutter Reliance you saw on the previous slide is of that class. So those cutters joined our service in the 60s. I think those of you listening to Admiral Zunkov yesterday had mentioned that on a ship visit to one of those, the chief of the engine room had told the visitor that this is the most cyber secure cutter in our class. There is absolutely nothing digital on it whatsoever. There's no connectivity at all. So from a cyber perspective, a great platform. The ships have been serviced very well over the last 5 decades, okay, 50 years old plus for the early ones in that class. They're tired, and they need some relief. OPC is also to relieve that class as well. Next one down is Cutter Eagle, Cutter Eagle joined the service as a war prize in World War II. So commissioned, I think, or built in 37, commissioned the Coast Guard in 44, 45-ish. So she's going through a 4-phase service life extension program. Even as we speak, she's up at the Coast Guard Yard. Below that is a 240-foot icebreaker up in the Great Lakes, relatively new, so we're sitting pretty well there. The next two below that are buoy tenders. I think they're new because they entered the service while I was in the Coast Guard, but they're coming up on midlife, believe it or not. Working on down, we hit our inland river tenders. The oldest one in that class of cutter turned 71 in November. And then below that, you see patrol boats. So we have our fast response cutters, and I'll talk a little bit about that on the next couple slides, that are the relief for that. And then at the very bottom is our polar icebreaker that Admiral Zunkov talked a little bit about, and I'll talk a little bit more about later as well. And so we got a reliever coming in for that. So next slide, please. So probably of those, of all those class of cutters, probably the ones that are probably near and dear to most of our hearts and would probably have most interest to you in industry are the OPC, the FRC, our National Security Cutter, and our Polar Icebreaker. So for kind of a status on OPC, we have three great teams that are working this. We have proposals that we're reviewing, and we anticipate making an award, down-selecting to one design, and doing that in part of this fiscal year, September time frame. Fast response cutter, phase one is still ongoing. That provides with 32 cutters. We've taken delivery of 16 of those. I think the 16th gets commissioned in this month. And there are 32 that are on the order books. We're working on phase two, which is a recompete. And we have proposals that we're looking at, and we anticipate making that award here sometime in May, June time frame for the phase two of that. And that would take us up to about 58 FRCs total in the fleet. NSC CETA, that's our structural enhancement dry dock availability. The first two NSCs that we took delivery of, our structural analysis indicated that we weren't going to have the fatigue life that we needed. So that is a post-delivery availability that's going to happen on the first two that we hope to award here in the spring that is significantly intrusive. We're going to tear a lot of the ship down to parade rest to install a better structure, thicker plate, that sort of thing. That's only for the first two. We were able to implement those improvements on hull three and beyond in production. And then the last one there is polar class icebreaker. Admiral Zunkov announced yesterday that we had a FedBizOps entry uploaded to FedBizOps yesterday, an industry package. So we're looking.
All right.
Very well timed.
Yeah, that was great. All right, so.
So last year
to
at
the
polar.
Jokers to the right. yeah.
Last year at the Black Engineer Award Conference, we had people getting up and dancing after this sort of thing. So I'll spare you that. For the Polar Industry Day, I'll just make it brief. We had a little glitch yesterday when we posted it. We fixed that. So for those of you interested, if you hit FedBiz Ops, there's two actual files in there. One, when you're trying to access it, is not going to let you because you may not have the clearance for it. The second one is identical. We fixed the issue. It's there. Go out and take a look at it. Do your downloads, that sort of thing. We'll wait until things quiet down before we remove the file on there that's not working. And we look forward to industry engagement on that. So I'll turn over so we have time for questions, sir.
Okay, great. Thanks, Bob. Joe, great guys in the panel. So our evil plan to use the entire time talking failed. So we've got about, I think, 15 minutes or so for questions. Hopefully not too many pre-decisional questions, but happy to go direct them to any of the panel members. And I am struck, and I think Secretary Mabus hinted at it, is the robustness of the shipbuilding that's going on in the United States of America right now. In spite of what you might hear, it's going pretty well. And these guys and their teams, along with their industry partners, get all the credit. So how about it? Who's got a question somewhere in the... Mark Vandroff, I hope you're going to ask your boss a question.
I am not, sir, because I get to talk to you and the other in navy blue there all the time and perhaps too much. So I actually have a question for Admiral Haycock from the Coast Guard. I don't see Sydney Freeberg in here, who would normally ask you a very obnoxious question. And since he's not here, I feel like you should be asked an obnoxious question, so I'm going to do it. So, for Polar Icebreaker, given the geopolitical situation in the Arctic, I'm interested in the Coast Guard's vision for the requirements for that ship. Are you viewing that as an icebreaker for commercial purposes, the facilitation of commercial purposes, of commercial activity, the way your buoy tenders are, that also has some self-defense? Or are you building a warship to take the fight to potential adversaries that also happens to crunch ice? And where's the requirement for that, the general requirement for that shaping up? And if you want to say inflaming things about potential near-peer competitors, I would like that even more.
So yesterday, I witnessed people trying to dodge questions and substitute questions they'd rather answer. I'm not really good at that. I'm going to give it a shot, and hopefully I'll answer your question. So the requirements document, the operation requirements document is nearly complete. It's been signed by the Coast Guard. It's at the Department of Homeland Security right now for their review and their signature. That document was put together using an integrated product team with like 11 different agencies, federal agencies. So the Navy got a cut on it, the Marine Corps got a cut on it, National Science Foundation got a cut on it. Lots of people had some input to that. So the document is nearly complete. We're waiting for approval by the Secretary, which will allow us to move forward. The thing that we downloaded or uploaded up to FedBiz Ops yesterday is not the entire ORD. It's pieces of it, enough that we hope will give industry kind of an idea of flavor of what we're looking for. The cutter is not designed as a Navy combatant. We have 11 Coast Guard missions. The cutter is designed, or at least we hope it's going to be designed, to satisfy probably 9 of those 11 missions. It's not really designed towards counter drug ops. The drug flow paths have not migrated to the Arctic yet. I say yet because you don't know. The adversary does have a say in the game. It's not really designed for migrant because we don't have a large migrant problem up in the Arctic either. All of our other missions, search and rescue, law enforcement, fisheries, pollution, things of that nature, the cutter needs to meet those missions, and that's why we need to buy a new asset as opposed to trying to lease one, because there's nothing that exists out there that can meet all those requirements. You could build a vanilla pickup truck like icebreaker that just crunched ice. Unfortunately, with the Arctic opening up, we're going to see a lot more traffic. With oil exploration, although it's tailed off, at some point in time that could pick up again. We need to be able to respond to pollution events, that sort of thing. One of the biggest drivers is the Antarctic mission. So annually we need to go down and break open a channel for the annual resupply of McMurdo Station. So that's, once a year they get a cargo ship and they get a tanker in, and that's their entire fuel and their entire supplies, food, and everything for an entire year. And so that really drives a lot of the mission requirements. So the cutter has got to be able to break at least 6 foot of ice. I think the objective is 8, things of that nature. So those are the sorts of things that drive that mission. I don't know how many people here have ever sailed on an icebreaker, but I've done the Antarctic mission a couple times, and it's a very it's a really nasty environment to be in. You're talking about chunks of ice the size of a VW that'll run through the screws, so the ship vibrates tremendously. So there's a lot of things that are going to drive the design from that. So I don't know. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, pretty good. Okay, good. Thank you so much. Next question, please.
Yes, sir. This is for Admiral Antonio. You talked about you did some comparison between Fort Worth and Freedom's deployments, and it sounds that Fort Worth has actually done very well, and her ace of O was probably higher. Is there a message here that maybe a particular class of ship may be deployed in one location versus another, number one, or is it really number two that possibly your processes for maintenance and getting items repaired has matured and improved over time?
Yeah, thanks, Dean. I didn't know it was you, otherwise I wouldn't have been so flippant. I'm sorry. I would not read into my comments that that one particular class of ship is going to operate in a particular geographical area compared to others. In fact, the plan is ultimately to have four ships operating out of Singapore, two of each variant. As you know, we haven't had the opportunity yet to deploy the Austal variant, but that's coming up in the near term. I say near term, probably in the next year or so, to get that ship out there. I know lots of interest is being placed on the LCS-2 variant with regards to mission packages, but we need to get that ship deployed to be able to do kind of the apples-to-apples comparison and give the fleet operational time with both variants of ships to be able to use them the way that they'd like to use them. Last year, RIMPAC 14, as you know, we deployed LCS-2 with a surface mission package, and she performed very well in RIMPAC. So, again, I wouldn't read anything into my comments about LCS-3 and Fort Worth and Freedom being in Singapore as those being the only ships that will go there. My point was that as the fleet gets more opportunity to use them, as we learn more in the shipbuilding program about applying lessons learned both on the building side but also on the sustainment and repair side, that the ships are continuing to improve operationally. Okay, we'll also continue to take lessons learned as we go along. In fact, we just took a brief a few months ago from the first skipper that deployed with Fort Worth and did the crew change out. He came and briefed the PEO. And so we're taking those lessons learned as well and trying to put them back in. Your second part of your question had to do with our maintenance processes and what the Fort Worth experience tells us about those processes. I would go back to the statement I've been saying, that we're continuing to learn as we go along. I mentioned during my talking points that we're going to continue to align with C-21, and Admiral Galinas is up here in the third row. He and I have just been talking. We're going to get even more integrated with the way that the processes work. As you know, we rely a lot more on contractor work across the board. We typically don't talk about traditionally the O, I, and D level maintenance. We talk about in terms of facilities maintenance, preventive maintenance, and corrective maintenance. And so we need to meld those together and make sure that the ships are as well supported as possible. But it doesn't do us any good to go off into a solo regime. We need to be aligned with the C-21 processes and products. Answer your question, Dean?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, the only other point of that was that the Trimaran variant ended up being the center mass for the mine mission module testing. That's pretty all-encompassing. It's taken a lot of those first two ships time to go get ready to go do that testing, and it's ongoing. So just the luck of the draw, almost. Yeah, next question, please. Thanks.
This is one for Admiral, another one for Admiral Antonio. Sir Ed Walsh, Naval Institute Proceedings. Can you comment at this point on the analysis of the problems experienced by Milwaukee last month?
So Milwaukee is currently in Little Creek at the base there, being repaired to a casualty that she sustained to her propulsion system. Publicly, I can comment that it had to do with the reduction gear, the combining gear specifically. There is an ongoing failure review board that's being headed up by C05X, and that failure review board findings will be completed here towards the end of the month in early February. That'll help us define in a very detailed way the root cause analysis and the way that we can move forward with making sure that we have a reliable system moving forward.
Yeah, I would say we haven't ruled out any, as we can say, that didn't cause it. There's probably pieces of design, et cetera, all the things you would expect in a failure review process are still on the table. So, yeah.
Thank you. John.
I'm sorry, sir, if I could just one more. So Lockheed Martin is also taking the advantage, is also conducting their own failure review board into the analysis as the prime contractor. So I didn't want to leave the impression it's just the Navy. Industry is also obviously very interested in making sure that we do the right thing.
Thank you. John Harper with National Defense Magazine. The Navy shipbuilding budgets for the 2020s are projected to be much higher than they have been historically. So how concerned are each of you that the money won't be there for you to complete or to move forward with all of the programs within your portfolio? Thanks.
So let me, I'll go first and then give the POs a chance to go through it. If you go back in history, as the requirements have been clearly stated and the need for the various capabilities of the Navy, the SCN budget has generally responded to that. The idea that's I would say is out there is that we've identified this need 10, 12 years in advance. We've been working on it, talking about it. The idea that there's no ability to grow any part of the budget, that it has to squeeze out everything else, I think is in question. I'm confident that the nation knows it needs a full range of capabilities of its Navy, and it knows it needs this replacement for the Ohio class to host something like 75% of our nuclear weapons from now till 2080. The impacts of the squeeze that might occur would be what the POs will address, but I think it's incumbent upon all of us to go say, is that the right use of the nation's resources and go make sure they're available. So you're the hog, so I'll let you go last. So I know, Brian, you want to go first?
No, I don't. I'll go back to my comments about momentum. Right now with funding LCS 25 and 26 in 16, we'll have workload going on for the next 4 or 5 years or so in both of the shipyards. So so there is that momentum that continues there. The Admiral's got it exactly right with defining the requirement. 30-year shipbuilding plan is put there for a reason to help meet what that requirement is. And then lots of balancing that needs to go on in terms of priorities happens each budget cycle. And what we tend to do is people, take bets on what the over-under is and that sort of thing. And until the President's budget comes out and we execute to the priorities that were established by the entire Defense Department, it's speculation to say that, money might not be there.
My offering would be, and I think I repeat what the Admiral said again, I think if we've got our requirement laid in what is otherwise a complex budget environment going forward, then we've at least communicated what it is that we said we needed all along. That's what we need to execute. And I'll just speak very quickly to where we ended up in 16. In my piece of shipbuilding in 16, we were plussed up $2.2 billion. To what the original requirement was, and a lot of programs, with that plus up were to accelerate things, move things to the left. So I think it's a year-to-year thing, but I think if you got your requirement laid in, I think we're having the right discussion on the Hill and elsewhere about what it takes to meet our shipbuilding requirements, sustain an industrial base in a budget-constrained environment.
Okay, so I object to the characterization as a hog, of course. A former boss of mine, I'd prefer to be known as a pig. A former boss of mine said, pigs get fed, hogs get slaughtered. What we have to understand is that we look at this as an every other generation responsibility. When we started our policy of nuclear deterrence after the end of World War II, the first class of SSBNs, which actually several classes, combined together to be 41 for freedom. So that was started the design work and integration into a nuclear submarine in the 50s and delivered them in the 60s. Then the Ohio class SSBN, which was delivered in the late 70s, early 80s, and now the Ohio replacement. But the interesting thing is, and I wish I had brought this slide, but if you go back and look at the amount of SCN money devoted to the construction of 41 for Freedom and Ohio, Ohio replacement as a percentage of the total DOD budget, it's actually very consistent. So yes, it is a spike up as compared to normal submarine procurement. But it is consistent with what we have done in the past when it came time to capitalize and then recapitalize our at-sea strategic nuclear deterrent. So it's a responsibility we take very seriously, and we're suffering too. I showed you on the shipbuilding plan that we can only build one attack submarine in the years that we authorize an SSBN, and that prevents us from more rapidly regaining our requirement of 48 SSNs in the fleet. But am I concerned that the money won't be there? I have great confidence in our leadership, both in the executive branch and the legislative branch, at working together to make sure that the money is there to recapitalize this mission. And then I dearly hope, for the Navy's sake, that they do it in a manner that allows continued progress on all of the shipbuilding programs.
Okay, and I'm sorry we're not going to be able to take any more. I'll just close that with this as a shameless plug for this afternoon's panel. The other thing that will come into play, of course, with all that is that we get the expected service life out of all the ships we have, probably 10 or 15 years past their service life if history is any guide. And so come this afternoon and hear all about the great work being done to maintain the fleet. And thank you all very much. See you later.